Hey everyone, Chris here with another filler video, and today I decided it was high time to put out an update to an old filler video I made way back in 2013 titled, So You Wanna Make Games. In that video, I discussed the process of how to go from being someone who simply has ambitions to make games, to being someone who's now not only making them, but marketing and selling them. However, back when I made that video, there were some interesting changes going on in the world of indie game development, spurred on by major indie successes such as Minecraft, and a shifting trend from marketplaces typically walled off from indies to suddenly open up wide to them. As such, I would say treat this video as an addendum to what I originally discussed, meaning you may wish to watch the original video first, which I'll have a link to in the video description. However, I do want to clarify a couple points quickly from that original video. One of the first things I went over was how to tell if you're going to actually enjoy making games or not, and if you'd be able to see one or more through to a finished product. Well, my opinions there haven't changed really, but you may go through those checks and still not be certain if making games is something you want to do. So there's one more check you can perform to truly figure this out. Even if you want to make money from selling your own games, but fail to make much of anything from a finished product, would you still feel the process was worth it? If that answer isn't yes, then you're going to have a rough time in the long run. Making games has to be more than just wanting such a game to exist. You have to enjoy the process, or the result is simply not going to be worth the trouble. All in terms of a lack of money, burned time, moments of being stressed out, among other things. The other point I want to clarify is in terms of setting up teams. I originally mentioned that a good portion of the time, indie game dev teams are built up out of friends who decide to get together and make something in their spare time, while splitting the income once the game is launched. However, if you happen to have a decent amount of money saved up, at least in the four-figure range, you may even consider commissioning art, music, audio, even code that you would otherwise have trouble making yourself. Now just bear in mind, this can get very expensive very fast, so the less stuff you have to commission, the better. You may also consider striking other more creative deals, such as a small commission with a royalty rate attached if you're able to get your game out, which is a deal better suited to friends, or you may wish to pay a creator to commercially use assets they've already made, which would be cheaper than having them make stuff from scratch specifically for you, which is the logic behind the asset stores seen with the more popular and powerful game engines. However, this leads into one of the big changes which has happened over the past decade, which wasn't quite as ubiquitous back when I first covered this topic. A little thing known as crowdfunding. Not that crowdfunding websites didn't exist, but they were still kind of a novel thing. Now, if you decide to go the crowdfunding route for your own game project, there's two very important things to keep in mind. The first is that you can't go this route unless someone on your team has experience launching a finished product, or you already have something tangible for people to try out to prove your dedication and skill towards the project. The thing is, people prefer to fund projects where there's a clear precedent set so that the risk of wasting one's money is minimized. If you can't prove that, then virtually no one's going to back you. The second thing to keep in mind with crowdfunding is that because you're getting a lot of money early, you won't get as much from the sales of the game once it's launched, since so many copies are going to be going out as rewards. Not to mention, crowdfunding sites often have considerable fees associated with using them. You need to take this into account to determine if it's viable to do it this way, and to help determine how much to even ask for, since you'd be using that money to do the thing I mentioned right beforehand, commissioning others to work on code and art and music and such. Also bear in mind that if you take the crowdfunding route, get funded, then fail to deliver, you've now burned the crowdfunding bridge, and no one's ever going to fund another one of your projects ever again. In fact, there's a lot of warning signs people check for to avoid funding dubious projects, such as when a developer decides to launch a second run of crowdfunding before delivering on the first run. Trust me, don't do that, not unless you want to make a ton of enemies overnight. Now let's talk a little about actually getting started. I originally mentioned that when getting into game development, the best thing to do is check out all the tools available to you and pick tools which work best for you. Well, since then, a lot more tools have become freeware, or free to a point, or have become more powerful, but more pertinently, the number of game engines accessible to indies has continued to go up. Now, I'm not going to recommend for or against specific game engines because I don't have experience with all of them, but I do want to point out a few things to keep in mind when selecting a game engine to use for your project. The first thing to consider is if your game is primarily 2D or primarily 3D, as this is going to very quickly dictate your engine choices, especially if you need to be capable of doing both 2D rendering and 3D rendering. And I don't mean like doing a HUD or menu in a 3D game, I mean if you're doing a 2D platformer or RPG which needs to have 3D rendered elements, or if you're doing a 3D game which needs to have complex 2D things rendered as 3D objects, then you're going to be even more limited on your engine choices. Regardless, you want to weigh all of your options and choose engines which look like they'll fit your ideas, your skills, your way of thinking, and ultimately your budget if it's not free. Though some engines don't come with a price tag until after you've made X amount of dollars, in which case, it's usually not that big a deal. As you're testing engines out, one of the key things to check are performance issues. Now, every engine is going to have bottlenecks somewhere in how it handles things, resulting in jitter in the frame rate or lag spikes or other such things, and every engine is going to have a means available to minimize these difficulties. Now, once you understand why the performance is being negatively affected, the trick is, can you fix it, and can you fix it easily enough that it doesn't make working with the engine a chore given the project you have in mind? The best example of this is that cutting-edge features in game engines under active development often aren't well optimized and thus might not be worth trying to use in anything you want to see through to completion. Aim to figure this out as soon as you can, because it's a heck of a lot easier to do an engine switch early in a project than later in a project. I myself was working with the Godot engine for the past few years, learning its nuances, but when it came time to try and make a proper game with it, I started butting against severe performance issues when using its most advanced 3D features, which did not have viable workarounds. Now, this likely won't be an issue in the long run, pretty much every game engine gets better with time when there's active development on them, but you absolutely have to keep stuff like this in mind and not be afraid to switch engines early on if you run into these kinds of problems. The other thing to consider is target platforms. Now, I typically focus on PC game development because Windows and Linux PCs are ultimately the easiest platforms to release games for. Well, heck, if you're releasing such a game for free, you don't even need to worry about digital storefronts at all. You can just make a quick website, plop a PayPal donation button on it along with your game, and just call it a day. Though bear in mind that if you do offer a download of your game for free, even if it's just a demo version, modern virus scanners and Windows Smart Screen will likely throw a fit when they detect the executable on someone else's computer and recommend they not run the software. This is all based on file trust systems working in the background, which indie devs don't really have a good way of bypassing on their own accord. Not without throwing a lot of money at certification services, which automatically scan and develop file trusts while providing security certificates to attach to your executable to validate its authenticity. However, if you want to develop for Macs, mobile devices, or more pertinently, game consoles, you need to make sure the engine you're using supports your target platforms. Also keep in mind that for game consoles in particular, you'll likely need a really expensive dev kit to enable that possibility in the first place, and that for mobile devices, the actual graphical capabilities are considerably weaker than you might expect, which limits what you can do without burning through battery life or killing the frame rate. The major changes though, since I initially talked about all of this, are the storefronts. Scroll back to the mid-2000s when I first released my own commercial titles, Super Minesweeper and Pixel Ships Retro, and services like Steam were still gated to AAA developers and publishers, meaning to sell software as an indie, you had to use third-party services which weren't specifically built around gaming and often had all kinds of hurdles consumers would have to go through to buy anything. Nowadays, though, you have storefronts like Steam, GOG, Epic, and several others, which all now accept indie game submissions and will even allow a solid quantity of them to go up. However, part of the reason they're so lenient now compared to how they used to be is because of the profit split, which is actually pretty egregious. But then at the same time, these services are gaming focused, so the people using them are already expecting to buy games from them, and these systems make it much easier to do so. Not to mention, there's been talk of these profit splits perhaps improving very soon with various storefronts. Definitely something to keep an eye on. This kind of leads into a common misconception though, which came up in the mid-2010s. Now sure, you can put your game on Steam or GOG or such, and they'll take a portion of the profit, but they are not an advertising service. As these services became more and more accessible to indie devs, there was a fear that they were doing less and less to help promote good indie software because of all the bad stuff flooding in, But the thing is, they were never in the business of doing that in the first place. And besides, what was your alternative? Go with a lesser known service which doesn't even deal primarily with games, which will intimidate people who try to buy your software and make even less of an effort to push your software due to a lack of community or recommendation features? I think a lot of people trying to launch their first indie titles in the mid-2010s didn't realize just how bad it was to not go with a well-established gaming storefront. The truth be told, marketing is still a big part of the experience, but social media is a lot more prevalent now than it used to be, and has become a far more approachable and acceptable means of marketing to some degree, since you can take out advertising space on these services, plus anyone who follows you will be doing so because they're eager to hear about things. So yeah, if you're going to be releasing indie games nowadays, you pretty much have to embrace social media, at least to some extent, to have any hope of making an impact, as raw advertising might alone not be enough. And besides, it can get pretty expensive pretty quickly. I remember doing advertising with Super Minesweeper back when I released it in 2005, and overall spent slightly more on ads than I got back in sales. Suffice to say, that didn't work out so well. This actually leads into another important thing if you have ambitions to sell games: the target market. Now, if you just want to make a game for the heck of it and don't care if it makes any money or not, then go ahead and make absolutely any kind of game you want with any kind of material in it. You're not beholden to anyone. But if you intend to monetize your game, you absolutely have to keep in mind not only the kinds of people who would be interested in the kind of game you're making, but also your competition. Now, don't let this aspect stop you from making what you want to make, but rather have it help dictate the direction you take things. For instance, if you're making a game which is going to visually appeal to children, don't use a lot of big words and complex character interactions in the story. Or if you're doing the opposite, making a game graphically disturbing, don't make the story so basic you'd find it in a preschool book. I mean, there's exceptions to rules like this, such as for sake of parody, but generally speaking, you're probably not making a parody game, so definitely keep stuff like this in mind. And I'm speaking from experience with this aspect too. Now, as mentioned before, I've never made a livable income off of my games, and that still hasn't changed yet, but it's not like I didn't sell any copies of my stuff at all. Heck, I still do. And it's not like I didn't learn anything. Super Minesweeper was the first game I ever tried to monetize, but had I done my market research properly, I would have found out that the target market I had in mind, people who enjoy Minesweeper, not only weren't interested in variants of the gameplay, but also had no desire to pay for Minesweeper, because they already had access to a free Minesweeper game, which was just the basic Minesweeper you would expect, but with advanced statistics for analyzing and optimizing one's play, which is all they wanted. To that end, there's a few genres I need to warn people about if you have monetary ambitions, the big one being dungeon crawls, or more specifically, games which play like the original Rogue. If you're not doing anything to break the mold with this genre and are just sticking with the tried and true gameplay of the original Rogue and NetHack and Angband and whatnot, you're gonna have a hard time getting people to buy your game just by nature of how much free stuff is out there. For dungeon crawls, you need to be unique with your mechanics to some degree to have any chance of selling your product. Another one I've mentioned before, but I feel bears repeating, is MMORPGs. These are the hardest games to make by far, and if you have any aspirations to make one but have no game development experience, then you just need to stop right now and go back to the drawing board because you're not ready for this one. Most MMOs have massive development teams and still take several years just to get out the door, and even once they are, requires a constant stream of support. Not to mention, due to their nature, often require you to set up your own payment systems and secure servers and get into anti-cheat stuff and deliver fresh content regularly to keep players playing. This is not a genre you want to dive into without plenty of prior experience to guide you, a good-sized team to command, and a desire to commit potentially a full decade of your life to it. One other genre you need to be cautious about though are survival games, i.e. games where the main goal is to avoid dying by doing tasks to help keep you alive, but otherwise don't have a well-defined goal. The reason you need to be careful with games like these is because the market is freaking saturated with them now. There's so many, and they often take so much time to get into that it's hard for players to want to get into new ones, as they'd typically rather stick with the one or two they already play. And don't think taking your survival idea into outer space is going to help either, that market's just as saturated. Because of this, if you go the survival game route, what you need to end up with has to be amazing if you want to have even a chance of making any kind of money off of it. Lastly, I want to touch briefly on a few game engines I know about, just to give some quick insights I have, based on either research I've done on them or experiences that I've had with them. Now again, game engines in active development are constantly being refined and improving. But that doesn't mean they never had issues. In fact, pretty much every engine has had some kind of issue or restriction or such at some point. Like, there is no perfect game engine. But this summary should at least give you an idea of where you want to go with things. Again, these are not recommendations that you use or avoid specific engines. I just want to make you aware of them so that you know they exist and can look into them yourselves. The two most popular engines for indie game development are typically Unity and Game Maker Studio, or GMS. Unity has been through a lot over the years, it can pretty much do just about anything, but I was never really able to get into its way of making stuff, and I've never been a fan of its more recent licensing models, where you can either use it for free up until your total annual revenue exceeds $100,000, at which point you're required to upgrade to a subscription-based copy, and pay a rather high monthly or annual rate per system it's being used on at a time. Game Maker Studio, on the other hand, is probably one of the easiest game engines to make something with, but that's partly owing to its focus on 2D with very limited 3D capabilities. Plus, in the past, it's had all kinds of performance issues. It's a lot easier on the wallet, though, with a one-time fee available if desired, or a cheaper annual subscription which allows upgrading to the permanent license at a discount at any time. Godot Engine is perhaps the fastest one to get started with, just because it's 100% free, unlike almost every other engine out there. It does both 2D and 3D and has many of the same features as Unity, but with different terminology, a proprietary scripting language, and as mentioned earlier, often hits performance issues when using its most advanced features, at least as of right now. Though it's going to be switching to the Vulkan API in the near future, which could be a game changer for it. Another 2D choice I often see utilized is Clickteam Fusion, which has had serious performance issues in the past with some systems, though it looks like most of that is behind them now. It's a much more visual scripting system than even GMS, with reasonable one-time fees to get proper export features and zero royalty payments. Now, you can technically go with older engines and often avoid most or all of the licensing stuff due to their age. For instance, the Build engine was recently used for the first-person shooter Ion Fury. But if you decide to go with an old game engine, chances are your game will be limited to the style of game that engine was built to represent. So in the case of a Build engine game, it's going to be a first-person game with an emphasis on shooting. Or if you're set on making a 2D fighting game, Mugen is a frequent free choice. But again, it's built specifically for that style of game, so it's only a choice if that's what you're aiming for. Or you may even decide screw it and skip using an engine in favor of making your own, despite the fact you'd be doubling your workload. But you may still want to use an SDK of some sort to provide a backbone for your engine so you don't have to mess with low-level stuff. To that end, I used to use the Allegro game programming libraries, which were designed for 2D, and come in both non-hardware accelerated and hardware accelerated flavors. Or if you want to get even more personal with the raw APIs, you can go with Simple Direct Media Layer, SDL. In both cases, you need to be well-versed in C or C++, though if you want to write stuff in BASIC, I frequently see both Dark BASIC and QB64 recommended. Dark BASIC if you want advanced features, or QB64 if you want to make something that acts much like an old Quick BASIC program, but within modern Windows. However, back in 2015, Epic Games decided to play an ace up their sleeves, and made their high-end Unreal Engine free to download. As you might expect, Unreal Engine is freaking powerful, primarily designed for 3D, but I'm told it has some 2D capabilities, though it's certainly not optimized for that. The trick is that not only is Unreal Engine a beast, requiring at least fairly powerful hardware to run the development tools, but it also has a lot of licensing considerations. Though as long as you comply with those considerations, they can end up working out better than even Unity in a lot of scenarios, with it basically coming down to being free from all royalties per product sold up until one of those products grosses $1 million, at which point a 5% royalty is assigned from that point forward for that specific product for the rest of eternity. For an engine as powerful as Unreal, this relaxed form of offering it for use to the public is a game changer, and partly explains some of the shift towards Epic's storefront and products in recent years. It also happens to be the engine I'm going to be learning next, starting very soon. Though my initial impressions are that it's a very different paradigm focused very strongly on visual scripting, but with the ability to directly code in C++ instead where desired. Definitely going to be interesting to experience using this thing as I move forward with my own game dev ambitions. And that's ultimately the important takeaway from all this. I still do game dev work all the time. I never stopped. Sure, I haven't released a completed commercial product since Pixelships Retro in 2006, but I continue to learn, continue to write design docs, continue to make assets, and sometimes have little things to upload for people to try. And sooner or later, I will ultimately have a completed project to show for it. But even if I don't, I just enjoy working on games. It's the one fundamental necessity to be doing any kind of indie development, because for every one indie success story out there, there's 100 or more failures. But these were typically people who wanted to make a game and enjoyed doing it, regardless of where they ended up. The lesson is, you can't jump into indie development for the money, nor can you jump into it just because you have an idea or want a particular kind of game to exist. You have to do it because you like doing it. Now, obviously, you won't really know if you like doing it or not until you give it a try, but always be watchful that you don't fall into the trap of doing it just to reach a conclusion that would somehow make it worth the stress or aggravation. Because if you're not enjoying the process, then the better thing to do is to take your idea and turn it into something completely different. A novel, a comic series, an audio drama, an art collection, a song, a poem, pins, stamps, merch, there are countless things you can do with an idea which aren't nearly as complicated or time-consuming as making a game. So if you do find yourself not enjoying the process, the best thing to do is pack it up and try something else. And don't feel bad about it. Game dev is hard and often thankless, and your ideas could be put into the world much faster by bringing it to other mediums instead. Anyways, that's all I wanted to say to update everyone on the indie game dev topic, and thus, that's all for this filler video. Next up in June will be a proper Ancient DOS Games review, episode 285, where we're going to be taking a look at an RPG that features ducks. No, it's not a DuckTales game, although wouldn't that be interesting if it existed, a DuckTales RPG? In any case, be sure to tune in on Saturday, June 5th, to see for yourself what game this is. Thanks for watching, everyone, and extra special thanks to those of you supporting me on Patreon. Here's just a small set of you guys.